14. Titan and Taboo rose together from their seats at the same instant. They walked slowly to the front of the room, their boots stomping noisily and in unison on the scuffed classroom floor. The room was absolutely silent. Outside, the sky had darkened and stone gray clouds began to accumulate. The leaves on the trees fluttered as though nervous in the unexpected winds, turning their backs to the sky. A cool breeze whipped through the open classroom windows with sudden fierceness as thunder rumbled in the distance. Miss Benson walked over to the windows and shut them quickly, making the classroom feel dismal and frightening, the electric lights a weak glow against the coming storm. Titan and Taboo stood in absolute silence at the front of the classroom. It was as if they had commanded the weather to be ominous as a natural background to their presentation. Titan spoke first. "This book, Lord of the Flies, is about death. The death of children." A huge flash of lightning followed by a room-shaking blast of thunder punctuated his statement. Delia jumped and gasped. The rest of the class looked around with fear. Miss Benson looked nervously out the window and at the two boys in the front. It seemed as if she had lost control, both inside and outside the classroom. Taboo followed. "It's also about evil, and how much evil humans, even little boy humans, are capable of. In the book, Jack and his hunters go crazy and let evil take over their good sense. I think the author was trying to use kids to show that everybody has a little bit of evil in them. Everybody," he repeated with emphasis. Titan continued, "And it's about fear. Fear of what you don't know and don't understand." The lightning and thunder continued to build, and outside the sky was almost as dark as night. Strangely, no rain had begun to fall, just the thunder and the lightning, in the thick, dark silences between each blast. Taboo looked out the window. "If I told you that this was the end of the world, would you believe me?" he asked the class. No one answered. Everyone was too scared. Titan asked them, "And if I told you that me and my brother were mass murderers, would you believe that?" Another peal of thunder answered. "Everybody at this school has acted just like the kids in this book," Taboo said fiercely. "You have treated us like monsters and killers when we have done nothing but mind our own business. Maybe the evil is in you and not in us. Ever think of that?" "Put it this way," Titan added. "Imagine a big black Rottweiler dog. Maybe two of them. They look scary. They growl and bark a lot. You think they're mean or evil. But maybe it's you that's bad, not the dogs. Ever think about that?" Except for the rumbling of the thunder, the classroom was silent. "But what about what you said on the TV show?" Delia asked finally, blurting out the question before she had a chance to think. She shrank in her seat as another loud explosion of the strange dry thunder shook the glass and the window frames. The twins never had a chance to answer, for at that moment the wind rose with a sudden fury, and the glass in one of the window panes shattered, shooting shards of glass like bullets across the room. Suddenly the lights flickered and went out, and darkness like nighttime enveloped the screaming students in the class. No one even noticed, except for Delia, when Taboo and Titan darted out of the classroom and into the hall. An outside siren started to blow, low and ominous, as the inside siren of the school alarmed as well. Mr. Lazaro's voice came through the loudspeaker. "This is an emergency. This is not a drill. We have tornadoes in the area. Repeat, this is not a drill. Teachers, take your classes quickly and safely to designated areas. If you feel you cannot get to that area safely, ask students to lie face down next to an inner wall and away from the windows. I repeat, tornadoes have been spotted in our area. This is a real emergency." A crashing sound could be heard through the speaker, then all was silent. The sirens outside and the sirens inside wailed continuously. Everyone screamed and ran from their seats, heading for the door. Miss Benson, although she was trembling, gathered all her strength and roared, "Silence!" The class, stunned for a moment, stopped and looked at her. "Lie on the floor, close to the wall, your bodies close together. No, away from the windows, you will be safe at that far wall. Huddle close to one another, quickly!" A gradual roaring, like a freight train thundering out of the sky, grew louder until it seemed to fill the room. The deafening noise was accompanied by the sound of breaking glass and thudding blocks of concrete. Delia didn't have to be told twice. She rolled to the hard floor and was amazed at how cool it felt. Lisa huddled close to her, sobbing loudly. Delia couldn't see where Jesse and Randy were, and Yolanda, Delia remembered, was somewhere between the classroom and the bathroom. But soon she could think of nothing but the deafening noise and the sound of breaking and grinding. It was as if the school were being attacked by bombs. It shuddered and shifted from the onslaught. She covered her head and trembled with each jolt, each crunching of glass, with each ripping of walls and bricks. Suddenly, all was silent. The throbbing train blew into dust and it was over. Outside, dark, ominous clouds hovered close to the horizon, as if they were not yet ready to leave such a scene. Slowly, the students sat up and looked around. The classroom was a mess. Every window was cracked or broken. The TV on which they had just watched their silly video had crashed to the floor, glass and pieces of electronic parts all over the floor. Several students' desks were broken. Miss Benson stood hesitantly and checked on the students. Jackie, Camilla, Omar, Zelda, Irene, Duffy, Princess, Andre, Deshaun, Zaheer, Lisa. Each student answered shakily that he or she was okay. Lisa was still crying, as were several other kids. Miss Benson continued checking for all her students, touching one and soothing the other. Jesse, Randy, Veronica, Ishiko, Max, Delia, Ching Lee, Bernardo, Hannah, Kristen, LaDonna, Shamika, Trevor, Yolanda. Her voice grew suddenly high-pitched and frantic as she yelled to the huddled children on the floor. "Where's Yolanda?" "Miss Benson," Delia screamed. "Yolanda went to the bathroom. She didn't come back." "Oh my goodness, Yolanda is out there somewhere," Miss Benson said with fear in her voice. She picked her way across the debris in the room and walked slowly to the door, close to where Delia was sitting on the floor. Miss Benson carefully opened the door, checking to see if anything threatened to fall on her head. Delia peeked out with her. She could not believe her eyes. Pipes lay on the floor and huge chunks of ceiling lay strewn about, tossed between broken glass and dangling wires. There was no sign of Yolanda or any other student. All was eerily still and dark. Miss Benson quietly closed the door. "What are you doing?" Delia screamed. "We gotta find Yo-Yo." Miss Benson put her hand on Delia's shoulder as she spoke to the class. "It's pretty bad out there, friends," she said solemnly. "It looks like we got hit by a tornado." Delia felt dazed. It had all happened so fast. One minute, they were sitting there, being scared by the Tolliver's presentation. The next minute, everyone was on the floor, huddling in terror, as all the horses of heaven stomped through the room. Delia jumped as someone touched her back. She looked around and saw it was Randy. "I've been right here the whole time," he told her. "I told you I got your back. It's going to be okay." Delia started to cry. She was so scared and shaky, she didn't know what else to do. "What about Yo-Yo?" Delia wailed after a moment. "We gotta find her." She headed for the door once more. "Sit down, Delia," Miss Benson commanded, blocking Delia's way to the door. "We don't know what kind of damage the building has sustained, and as long as I know that you are safe here, I'm going to do my best to keep you that way. This is a school, and all kinds of rescue people will be here in a matter of minutes to get you out safely. Yolanda is probably safer in the hall anyway. That was where we were supposed to go in a tornado, remember? There just wasn't enough time. Now we're staying put until help arrives. Got that?" Delia sat down grudgingly. She tried not to think about what might have happened to Yolanda. They could hear the sirens in the distance then. Hundreds of them, it seemed. Help was on the way. "Hurry," Delia prayed silently. "Please hurry." "Miss Benson, what will happen now?" Lisa asked shakily. "I'm not sure, Lisa. If the rest of the building is as bad as our classroom, we're looking at some time off, it seems," she answered. "But I don't want to hear any cheering. People may have been seriously injured. Let's take one step at a time. I'm just glad that most of you are safe and accounted for." "Miss Benson," Delia said quietly. "Are you okay, Delia?" Miss Benson asked kindly. "I'm terrified about Yo-Yo, but fine." "But Miss Benson, not everybody is accounted for. We forgot about Taboo and Titan. They ran out of the room when the storm first hit. They're not here."